Good afternoon. How's everyone tonight?
Good.
Perfect.
Good. So, as she said, my name is James or Jim Andrews. My company is IRR or Integra Caribbean. So, we have the franchise of a U.S. based company that specializes in valuation. Most of the offices are predominantly commercial real estate valuation. We do a combination of real estate, quasi business real estate, like going concern real estate, like hotels and things like that, around the Caribbean region, and then also straight up business valuation or valuations of companies and the equity in companies. That's sort of been my specialty for about the last 10 years is on the business valuation side. And we have other people in our company that do more on the real estate side, and then we kind of collaborate on projects that involve both. And I've been doing this for about 32 years now. And about the last 20, I've been in Cayman for 21 years, so very familiar with the territory here. What I do like to do to just sort of understand, you know, who I'm speaking to and sort of try to cater the presentation a little bit to the audience, if we can go around the room and just give me a quick name and what you do and what your level of interest is in this subject, whether it be you're a business owner and you want to know what your own business might be worth, or you would want to get into the field of practice, or you want to expand your knowledge of finance and that type of thing, or whatever it is that you're interested in learning, that would be great. So we can maybe start on this side.
Hi, my name is Madhavi Matua, and I am the accounting head for Associations. Entrepreneur, and my interest in this, I get clients from time to time that ask me about valuations. I know a little bit because I've done a little bit before, but it's not my expertise.
Did you come to one of the other SMEs?
Yeah, I've come to a couple of them.
And I think I've sent you some referrals once or twice, people looking for outsourced accountants.
Yeah.
Great.
My name is Emmy Cook, and I own Island Map Company, the illustrated
okay.
tourist map.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm just curious about the value of that and kind of growing it as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
Marsha Raj, we are future entrepreneurs.
Okay.
So we just came just to see what we can sort of take away from the food shelf fund.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Are you interested in starting a business or buying one?
Start one.
Okay.
Back here.
Andrash,
you're
a
and I own a business in Cuba.
I'm challenged
for sitting on how to get the
value
of
those. That's going to be interesting. I have done one valuation in Cuba.
Oh,
really? Yeah, it was a hotel property. That was a business property hotel. But,
which hotel was it?
A Saratoga.
Yes.
Yeah. Right in Maine and Maine. what did you say? Kendra,
was
it?
Kendra.
Kendra, okay, great.
Hello, I'm Leroy Warrens. I'm an operations manager and a graduate management student as well. And
okay.
Looking at being a future investor, so I'm interested in everything you've got to say this evening.
Not his first time either.
No.
Go ahead.
My name is Jose Montero Jr. I'm an IT manager slash consultant government. I've been involved in a startup in Central America, but I'm obviously very interested in valuations as it relates to growing a business and even finding other businesses in that area.
Okay.
Yeah, Central America.
Sounds good. Let's start the front row.
Oh, I'm Camille Burke. I'm a senior associate at Duff & Phelps, and my main work is doing liquidations.
Mm-hmm.
Just interested in your topic, so I'm here to learn something from you.
Are you spying for Duff & Phelps?
I mean, the part of Duff & Phelps is valuation,
yeah.
But I don't work on that side. I liquidate business that are in trouble.
For those of you who don't know, they have a massive, probably one of the biggest in the world, business valuation practices around the globe. But I don't know if they actually do business valuation in Cayman or strictly.
No, here it's just called liquidation.
Yeah.
So I don't get to dabble in that.
Yeah.
And I'm not spying on them.
Yeah. I was joking.
I know, but it's I'm good with the community.
Yeah.
I was just interested in learning more about business. I mean, I'm toying here and there with growing my own business, but I want to learn a lot more before I step up. So I just want to know more about it.
Okay.
Hello, I'm
Jane Peck and I'm a bookkeeper. I work with a company called GoPro Accounting, who are forensic accountants. I have numerous clients that always ask me, how much is my business worth? I know how I would value it, so it'd be interesting to see if I'm going down the right that road.
Okay, good to know.
Yeah, my name's Mike. I just run a small consultancy, and I'm just interested in how one does value a small business and how one appreciates or values goodwill.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how long you've been in the business or whatever.
Okay. I feel like we've met before.
I do as well. I'm trying to think where.
Yeah.
It wasn't at the same one last year. That was spoken of, but yes, I feel that we have met somewhere
okay.
right before.
All right, we'll figure it out along the way,
yeah.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
Back row.
Hi, my name is Mary Luz. I am running clothing retail store.
Clothing store? Okay.
I'm her husband, Kevin Kirby, and she started a clothing store probably about 6 years ago, and she's developed into a very successful store. And I'm an accountant, just having a general interest in seeing how you would value the business.
So it's good. Which clothing store is it?
It's called Studio M in Rankin Plaza.
Okay.
Men and women's clothing store, and then there's a unity side where they do wedding dresses.
Late people get to sit up front.
You can. You have to. Thank you. I think we can hit everybody except yourself.
There's one more lady behind me.
Okay.
hi, I'm Polly. I'm an alcoholic. No, sorry, wrong lady. Wrong lady. I'm Polly Pickering, Managing Director of eShore LTD. It's a IT cybersecurity consulting firm, hopefully taking care of people's stuff, keeping it safe and secure. Been in business 12 years. Here for 22 years.
Yep.
And my husband was signed up too, but he's obviously even later than I am. So.
Okay. We've met before.
Okay.
Yeah. I know your sister, I think.
Pamela Webster.
Yeah.
We're twins, so.
Right. Right. And what is your level of interest in business valuation?
I have a lot of people who are courting my company, so.
Oh, that's a good place to be in.
It is, yeah, and I like being courted, so I'm just
mm-hmm.
filling up more information.
Okay. Well, what I'll do is go ahead and sort of get started, just as by way of background. I know a couple of you may have been in one of my presentations before. Sorry, we have one new intro.
Sorry, Jackie, fine.
Jackie?
Uh-huh.
Nice to meet you. Where are you from? Or I'm not from here, but what do you do?
Just a little bit of real estate. I have.
Okay.
Yeah. Apartments, and then I also do a tourism sidekick. So
okay, and your interest is kind of to understand what your businesses are might be worth or how to look at it. Okay,
absolutely.
So I'll somewhat apologize to. Sorry,
it's always going to get away.
Nirmala, I'm
Nira.
Nirmala.
Okay.
I'm the accountant at Tortuga Rum Company, so
okay.
it's in my field, so I just wanted to see what it is about. So.
Okay. I was at the CEO, came in, what is Economic Outlook, and met a gentleman from Tortuga that does he's on the sort of CFO side of it or something, financial side of Tortuga.
Is it Marcus Simmons?
Pardon?
Marcus Simmons?
Maybe, yeah, I think that's right, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Nice guy.
Yeah.
So, somewhat of an apology to a few of you who have been here before. There's going to be some duplication, but not entirely. Most of the time when I give these talks, we tend to gear them more towards business owners and entrepreneurs in terms of helping them evaluate their own business and figuring out ways to improve cash flow and thereby increase the value of their business, or maybe ways to tweak their business and things like that. And this one is a little bit different in that it is geared really more towards the valuation of businesses, and as such, it's tricky. It's difficult to do. We have a wide variety of participants in terms of your background. We have a few accountants in here. Maybe some of you have more knowledge in accounting even though you're not necessarily professionally trained as an accountant or whatever, but we have different levels of understanding of accounting and finance and different backgrounds, and so we do try to, I try to put it into the context of, into layman's terms as much as possible. But anytime you get into valuation, if you're going to get into it in any level of detail that really gives the meat, if you will, without saying, just hire me and I'll tell you what your business is worth, you have to get into some of the nuts and bolts of it. And so there is some element of technical side to it. And so I'll have to, if I start seeing a lot of eyes getting glazed over, then I'll like, okay, I need to breeze over this section and kind of go a little bit further. So, but that's kind of what it's about. It's a combination of how businesses are valued, how we do it from a professional side, a sort of 30,000 foot level of that, if you will. But also, if you're a business owner, here are some of the things that maybe you can look at in terms of, well, if I wanted to increase the value of my business for a possible investor, how would they look at it if they were looking at it from an educated point of view, and or just to understand what it's worth in case I ever want to sell it, or in case I want to do some succession planning and that type of thing, or estate planning, various things. So, click. Just turn it off. I'm gonna have to make the clicker work. Okay. So some of these intro parts might be a little bit duplication. Some principles of good business, of course. This is speaking to, from an entrepreneurship level. Vision, perspective, effective leadership, and innovation. So these are kind of the core elements of things that one needs to be an entrepreneur. And on the subject of entrepreneurship, Steve Jobs says, why join the Navy if you can be a pirate? Yeah. And on the subject of risk, I like this one. Failure is not an option. It comes bundled with the software. So we all know this. If we've started companies and tried to do things, that sometimes you have to try different things to make it work. On success, the successful man is the one who finds out what is the matter with his business before his competitors do. And on innovation, I will either find a way or I will create one, but I will not make an excuse. And this is what I printed off the other night and put in a huge, as big as I can print, letters and taped it to my kid's bedroom wall. Because we're trying to avoid the excuses. So why should you care? Well, you might probably know why because you're here, but some of the reasons why we get into business valuation and the reasons why people hire us to do them, wealth and retirement planning, and you know, right now is business valuation is huge. It's becoming bigger and growing as a profession because baby boomers are reaching retirement, and they are, many of them are entrepreneurs and are looking for exit plans and exit strategies and willing their businesses. And actually, in the States, Donald Trump just made that even more popular because he raised the maximum tax level that you can gift without inheritance tax. So now all of a sudden, instead of putting people's businesses in trusts, they're saying, well, I'm going to give my business because now it's up to $8 million you can just gift to your kids. I'm just going to gift them so that now the kid has an $8 million or whatever it is base that's their floor, and then they would have to pay tax on anything that they realize over and above that when they exit. So succession planning, all that plays into it. People want to know how to get out of their businesses and the best way to structure a sale. Maybe it's to their employees or to their partners or whatever. Share sales. I would say 90% of the company valuations I've done here in the Cayman Islands have been simply somebody selling their business. And it's usually 100% sale, but sometimes people own a 50%. The last couple I've done have been 50% deals where you've had two different partners involved or two different families involved, and one's buying the other out. Financial reporting is a slightly different twist on valuation because it's actually a different standard of value than we do with all those other things. So it's a fair value standard rather than a fair market value standard, which is different. Litigation, unfortunately, you have shareholders getting into arguments and disputes or...
I think that's someone, sorry.
Yeah.
Get in here.
Someone try to come in?
I think he walked around here.
Were you locked out?
No, I was warned to not walk across some black thing.
Okay. What's your name?
Shamari.
Shamari?
Yes. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
If we have a question, should we ask now or wait for the...
Yeah, you can ask.
Like, if you were to sell a business in Cayman, would you recommend that it be incorporated or a sole proprietorship that could cause some problems? A sole proprietorship?
So, Cayman's different than Canada and the U.S. when it comes to that. Because in Cayman, basically, we can talk about company structures if you want. I mean, you can have... Most operating businesses that require trade and business license here are actually called ordinary resident companies.
Right.
And you can register yourself, if you're Caymanian, you can register yourself as a sole trader and have a sole proprietorship without registering an ordinary corporation.
Right.
You still have to have the same pension requirements, insurance requirements, and all of those things. But basically, there's no difference. If you have an operating company here that does business locally in the Cayman Islands, it has to be, you know, and you're hiring people on work permits, you have to have an ordinary resident company. If, on the other hand, you're doing business offshore completely, you can have what's called an exempt company, which is exempt from some of those Caymanian restrictions. It doesn't need a trade or business license.
So for selling a business in the Cayman Islands, for you, it wouldn't make any difference whether you're incorporated or not?
All businesses are incorporated here. They're not, so in the U.S., for example, and I don't know about Canada, but in the U.S. you have what's called pass-through entities like LLCs and S-Corps, which are corporations, but they're pass-throughs, and then you have partnerships and other forms of business entities, but here, any sort of operating business is technically incorporated. If you structure a business here, it's either a legally a resident ordinary company or it's an exempt company, and there's also an LLC, but those are typically designed for funds,
right,
not for operating businesses.
So the tricky thing being that, you know, majority of the businesses here being Caymanian owned, if you're selling to a non-Caymanian, I think that's a bit of a interesting water to navigate because people don't understand that you can buy the assets business, but then what are you going to do if you don't have Caymanian status?
You apply for an exemption under the LCCL.
Yeah, and we can talk about that. And on the valuation side, do we add risk premiums for these kind of things because there's a fewer, smaller pool of potential purchasers involved when you can only sell to either one Caymanian or 60% ownership Caymanian without that LCCL, which is something that could take a long time to get, and depending on what type of business you're in, you may not be able to get it. If you wanted to start a construction company here, for example, that's 100% foreign owned, would you get an LCCL for that?
Probably not.
Yeah.
It depends on who's regulating the type of business. If it's something that's under the trade and business licensing law, you might have a few more hoops to jump for that.
Yeah.
Financial services is a little more open than that.
Right, that's correct, yeah. So he strikes on a good point. A lot of this depends on the type of license that the business requires. So legal financial services have different licensing, and anything that has to do with monetary authority or on the medical field, that's completely different too. As opposed to us, we just simply have a trade business license to operate as a consulting firm.
Right.
So.
But it's not corporate.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Hers is. I was wondering. If she wanted to sell it, she should incorporate.
So she's a sole trader.
Right.
Okay. So we're gonna talk about, you can sell a business in two ways, just as she mentioned. You can sell a business at the asset sale, or you can sell the structure, the entity. And if you sell the structure, then you kind of, there are reasons, there are pros and cons. And this is actually a slide that's coming up, but the pro of selling an entity rather than the assets is that they've already gone through a lot of the bureaucracy, setting up the licenses and all of those things. But you're also taking in on the risk, if you're the buyer, you're taking on the risk of contingent liabilities. Anything that you don't know that's happened in the past that could come up and haunt you. So for that reason, a lot of people buy the assets of a business and not necessarily the entity itself. If your primary market, and again, it just depends. Like, it depends on how difficult it would be for someone to replicate what she's done. If it's just a matter of, you know, I'm Kay Manny and I can go down to the company registry and fill out the documents and get what I need to do, it's probably better just to buy the assets than it would be the entity. But in some cases, it's going to be more difficult depending on what licenses you have to get, things like that.
Well, just a bank account in the Cayman Islands is got a massive amount of value because it takes forever to get.
It takes forever. Yeah, but by the same token, if you go in there and you buy the entity and you go in there and you sit down and you say, okay, now I need to be the signatory on this bank account, you got to provide the same KYC information you would to get a new one anyway. So,
what about the goodwill in there, the business itself? I mean, it's been around a couple of years or several years, and got established and everything, I'm sure.
You're jumping ahead about an hour.
By extension.
Okay, so let's move on a little bit. So the basic definition of business, you guys probably know this, but here are some good ones. A commercial or industrial enterprise and the people who constitute it, the people being a very important part of that. Because most people don't realize that people, and that constitutes part of your goodwill that you're talking about, make up a significant amount of the assets in some businesses. An organization operated with the objective of making a profit from the sale of goods or services, an enterprise, commercial entity, or firm in either the private or public sector concerned with providing products or services. But in a real world view, a group of individuals with a plan or a strategy incorporating systems and procedures to efficiently utilize the tangible and intangible assets that they have available to meet the needs and wants of their identified customer base. And this is a valuation, so this is the American Society of Appraisers, their business valuation definition of what constitutes a business. Basically, a business constitutes a strategy, systems, people, and then you have tangible and intangible assets. So in a real world view, highly successful businesses have the ability to get the most out of the manageable parts of the business, the strategy, the systems, and the people. And those are the successful entrepreneurs. So the concept of enterprise value. Enterprise value is one of the most misunderstood terms in our field, because enterprise value does not, for example, I was listening to the chairman of the board. I'm a franchisee of the company. I mentioned this out of the States. And so the chairman of the board was talking about the value of our stock. And he said, so if you add up, you know, our stock is currently trading at $15 a share. You add it all up, and the enterprise value is X number of million dollars. And that's not enterprise value. That's the market capitalization, right? The enterprise value of your company basically means all of the invested dollars that support the value of the assets. So it can mean equity and it can mean debt. So your stock price adds up to your equity, right? All your investors that own in that company own equity, but that's not necessarily the value of the enterprise, because you might also have debt funding that enterprise as well. So enterprise value really equates to the value of the assets, which can be funded by both equity and debt. And it's the value driven by the earnings that is caused by the use of the assets. So remember that for a business to be profitable and to be a going concern, which I'll talk about, the cash flow from the business has to support the value of the assets. If it doesn't, then you have a problem. And financially speaking, for those of you who know a little bit about accounting, this is basically a way of looking at a balance sheet. And you can equate the structure, financial structure of a business to a balance sheet in this way. You've got assets on the left, and you've got liabilities and equity on the right. Remember, for those of you who know accounting, working capital is basically your current assets minus your current liabilities. So that portion flows here. And then from this line down, you've got the invested capital or the enterprise value. You have the fixed assets, you have other assets, and you have intangible assets. And that can include goodwill. Intangible can include goodwill. All these things are funded by this, equity and debt. So your invested capital, which is the same as your enterprise value, is the equity and debt that supports the value of the assets, including working capital. So, go ahead. What's your name?
Jonathan.
Nice to meet you. Anybody have any questions on that? Because this is kind of the cornerstone of where we go from here. So if you have any questions on that and you're not an accounting-minded background person, feel free to jump in.
You mentioned the enterprise value. Are you basically saying the company's ability to turn to use the equity and the debt in creating a return for the stakeholders? Is that really the enterprise value?
So, yes, because leverage increases the yield to the equity investor. So when you think about it this way, money is flowing from equity and from debt over here to fund the value of the assets. So if you're going to buy a manufacturing plant, you have to spend $1 million on assets, you don't have it all, you and your equity investors put up half and you go to a bank or whatever and you borrow the other half and you fund that. Maybe you did have the money, but you don't want to spend all of your money on it because you want to leverage it and create a greater return. Because remember, the lower the return, on debt, so if you get a low interest rate, you want a greater return on your equity, the overall return on the assets that you purchase by using your equity and your debt gets greater. So you're using leverage to increase the return on your assets that way. So that's kind of nuts and bolts of finance right there. So invested capital and enterprise value is really the same thing. There's a couple of minute differences in the definition, depending on what background you come from, but it basically includes a combination of all equity and long-term debt. Remember, short-term debt is part of working capital. So that's part of your current assets less current liabilities equals working capital. Working capital plus your fixed assets, your other tangible assets, and your intangible assets are what you're financing for the enterprise value. All the capital invested by both the equity shareholders and the financiers that create the value of the enterprise. Invested capital always equals the total value of the assets, also referred to as enterprise value, and this is not the value of equity. So we already talked about net working capital being current assets less current liabilities. Cash and short-term assets expected to be converted to cash within a year, less short-term liabilities. Businesses use net working capital to measure cash flow and the ability to service debt. A positive net working capital indicates that the firm has money in order to maintain and expand its operations. So, in what situation can you think of where a business might have negative working capital?
It could be that they're selling their goods, but they're not bringing in the money from it, and they have bills to pay. Yes, but their money is owed, but they don't have the cash. If a bill becomes due, they cannot pay it,
mm-hmm.
even though they have people owe them money.
Well, yeah, if you think about the type of businesses, though, like for example, a service business that doesn't have inventory. So inventory is a current asset. Basically, your current assets were typically cash, inventory, and receivables. But let's say you don't have receivables because somebody walks in and they pay you. Like if they paid me every time I did something for them, and I don't carry any inventory, but yet I pay my bills in 30 days. I can have negative working capital that way. But generally speaking, you want to have positive working capital because it shows that you have liquidity and solvency, that not liquidity, but more so solvency, the ability to service your short-term obligations.
So in that sense of the internal solvency, while you may have, say on your books, you have a lot of people owing you money.
Mm-hmm.
But if you cannot, if those are either bad or not coming in on time, you don't, the bottom line for that is the fact that you cannot pay your debt when it becomes due. So in a sense, that would be the problem where you have negative, basically it's negative liquidity because you don't really have the money. Yes, people owe you, or maybe you have to, now on your books you are showing all the sales that have been made and receivables are there.
Mm-hmm.
But if you are not managing that aspect of it and bringing the money, though you have those on your books, you can't pay your staff, can't pay utility.
Right.
You know, that's your problem.
But yeah, you would not be carrying, if you have negative working capital, you aren't carrying enough cash on hand to offset the fact that you don't have receivables, right? And you still have payables. Mm-hmm. So you have to have enough cash to meet your short-term obligations. But we do see it. Negative working capital does happen for some types of businesses. Intangible assets can include copyrights, patents, trademarks. So that's what we call intellectual property. And I keep waiting for the phone to ring on that a bit more because Cayman recently passed some intellectual property law. That means that we're probably going to get more, the idea is to get more IP registrations here. Brand, customer base, franchise agreements, designs, technology, software, contracts, leases, rights, agreements, assembled plant, assembled workforce, etc. So the workforce is your people, and that can be worth something. Unidentified intangible assets is everything else, and this is where we get into your subject of goodwill. So everything else that doesn't account for physical assets and identified intangible assets flows into the unidentifiable or the goodwill. So it's the value from the profit not otherwise attributed to identified assets. And there are types of goodwill that can be identified, such as personal goodwill, which is what the gentleman in the back is talking about, which isn't necessarily a good thing with the value of your business. So in a nutshell, how do we value goodwill? How do we recognize goodwill? So let's say we value a business on the basis of its assets, and we come up with a value of $500,000, and then we value it on the basis of its cash flow, and theoretically all the inputs are correct, and we come up with a value of $750,000, then, you know, we could potentially have $250,000 in value there that's not accounted for on the basis of the tangible and identified intangible assets. So the rest could be caught up into goodwill, and it could be different types of goodwill. Goodwill can mean the work and sweat that you've put into your business, the sweat equity, if you will. Goodwill can also mean that you've developed a reputation, either for your company name or for yourself. And it can also mean anything, everything else that means that you're making a profit over and above what your assets would justify. And service-built businesses will have a greater amount of goodwill by nature than one that sells products, or one that manufactures, or one that relies more heavily on physical assets for its operation. And from an accounting standpoint, I will take it one step further. When we're doing financial reporting or evaluation for financial reporting, let's say there's a transaction and one company buys another company and they said, we have to have this purchase price allocation done, right? So it's either under the American system or under the IFRS system, but basically it's the same thing. You have to go through and say, one company spent $20 million on this other company, and you have to go through and allocate how much of it was for the different things, like the physical plant, the real estate, and then all this and all this and all this, and then come down to goodwill. When you identify the goodwill, the company has to have that goodwill tested for impairment periodically, figure out whether or not the goodwill has gone up or down in value. Because everything else gets either depreciated or amortized over time. The goodwill doesn't, so you test it. So back to the basics. Businesses are either a going concern or they're not. And a going concern business is one that has the highest and best use of continued operation. And the highest and best use means when I look at a business, that's the first thing I ask, you know, when somebody says, you know, how much would you charge to do a valuation of my business? You know, one of the first things I ask, quite frankly, is, are you profitable? Because it makes a difference on how we look at the company valuation completely. And what defines a going concern as opposed to not is really whether or not there's enough profit to support the value of the assets. And if there's not, then theoretically the highest and best use is to liquidate the company and not to continue as a going concern. And you value one on the basis of its assets and not on the basis of its cash flow. So, if the value of the enterprise is equal to or less than the value of the net assets, the assumptions is liquidation. Otherwise, you're valuing on income. So those are the two valuation premises, liquidation premise or a going concern premise. And that's where we start. Liquidation premise means the business value is the sum of the values of the assets less debt. And we do that on a method of valuation called adjusted net assets method, which we'll talk about. And the going concern premise means the business is valued based on its projected earnings or cash flow. If anybody has any questions at any time, just raise your hand. We'll get into that. So I mentioned earlier about standards of value. Fair market value is what it means. It basically means there's a hypothetical transaction that occurs in our minds between willing sellers and willing buyers within a normal pool of market participants, and they're acting without undue stimulus or some strange impulse, without necessarily having synergies to account for, and the business has been adequately marketed. And that is the basis or the standard of value that we would use when we're doing evaluation for a share sale, a transaction, what do you want to know if your business is worth, or for tax purposes, or for investment or exit planning, or any of those things. You have two types of fair value, one that's used for financial reporting purposes and one that's used for litigation purposes. And there are different definitions involved, but essentially the fair value used for financial reporting purposes is typically a little different than fair market value because you can identify the parties involved. So let's say you have one company buying another company and they have to report this on their balance sheet. The parties are involved. This is how much would this transaction, the way I think about it is how much is this transaction between these identified parties, how much should that be worth? And in some cases, for example, if there are synergies involved, those would be taken into account. So oftentimes when there's a merger, or an acquisition of one company by another, there's a reason why, because they have some synergistic reason to do it. So usually, when there's a merger, there's a premium price paid over and above, I mean, like if you want to look at public companies, over and above the public price of stock for that reason. So fair value can be different than fair market value for that reason. For litigation purposes, it depends on what jurisdiction you're in, but oftentimes when you have a shareholder dissent or a shareholder lawsuit between shareholders, or perhaps one group of shareholders is dissenting against a merger or some transaction, typically the courts will rule that the value should not be discounted. So, for example, we're going to talk about partial interests and why partial interests are usually worth less in the open market than whole interests are on a pro rata basis. So unless you're talking about buying shares in a public company, which is a little different because that's highly marketable. I can go out and buy shares of Apple right now. then I can sell them as quickly as I want. That's marketable. But if I wanted to sell a 20% interest in my company, is it worth 20% of the whole? It might not be. Probably isn't. That is fair market value. So fair market value, 20% of my company is going to be discounted for lack of marketability, for lack of control, and we'll talk about that. But when you're talking about fair value for litigation, and let's say I own 10% and I'm in a lawsuit with my other partners over something and the court gets involved, they're going to say that I shouldn't have the value of my shares discounted for that reason because I'm here and I'm involved and that's me and those are the parties of the transaction, those are the parties of the situation that's at hand. So when you think of fair value, think of you can actually identify the parties involved and you can cater the value to that situation. And here I talk about again, the fair market value of partial interest is often discounted for lack of control and lack of marketability. Mm-hmm. Lack of control, it varies depending on the situation. If you have 10% shareholders, everyone might theoretically have equal control, but it's still not as much control as if you have 51%. But if you have one guy that owns 75%, one guy that owns 25%, the guy that has the 25% has a significant control issue that the 75% owner doesn't have. Lack of marketability simply means it's a lot harder to sell a partial interest than it is a whole interest in something.
But what about control? It's not necessarily the shareholding that after determining your control. You might have a 10% holding, but if you're sitting on the board, that paints a different picture.
So part of it depends on the partnership agreements with the shareholder documents in place. So you have operating agreements or partnership agreements, and sometimes even in the company documents like the Memorandum of Articles of Association will have clauses in there that might talk about the voting of shares and how that works. So we have to look at those documents when you value a company and see what they say. Because if somebody says I want a 20% share in my company appraised or valued, I have to know which, whose, you know, so I can look and figure out what actual amount of control they have. But if somebody owns a minority interest in a company and they're also a director sitting on the board of directors, that doesn't necessarily mean that if they sell their shares that that other person would automatically have a seat on the board unless the company documents say so.
So that's the same, a person can have 1% ownership of the shares, but don't necessarily control the company.
Right. That's true.
They need a capacity in shareholders, really.
Yeah, it's very unusual for one share not to have one vote. 75 shares to have 75 votes.
It all depends on the classification of your shares.
Yeah.
So you have control in shares, management shares, and you have participating shares.
Yeah.
You may have even 75% holding in the participating shares, but the management shares who decide what happens to the company.
Exactly. So when you do these kind of partial interests, you have to know all those things, and you have to go through all those documents and act accordingly. So I talked about the standard of fair value, both for litigation and financial reporting, usually not discounted for partial interests. For litigation, it depends on the jurisdiction. We're good on that. So we've kind of touched on this. You have different levels of value. So if you start, let's say you own 100% of your company, you have this. You have a control value right here. When you have a merger between two companies, as I mentioned before, oftentimes they'll pay more because they have synergies. One company buying another one to increase their market share or to add a product that works synergistically with the product that they're already selling, or they get a more, creating more, a little bit more of a monopoly. You know, there are different reasons why the synergistic value can be more than the control value. Then you have a marketable minority interest, and you know, obviously the easiest example is a shares in a public company is a marketable minority interest. But there may be situations where you have companies that are privately held. There are situations where there are privately held companies with many partners that have marketable minority interests. And a good example of that would be a law firm. You know, there are other lawyers that will, given the opportunity, pay for equity in that law firm. But they might not get control because they only own 5% or something, and they might not really have any sort of ability to control the votes. So the difference between this and this is called a control premium, and on the reciprocal side, that's our discount for lack of control. So the way this is done is you have different studies. So for one example, there's one called Partnership Profiles. And Partnership Profile studies thousands of transactions of shares in things like real estate holding companies, where you can easily identify what, you know, what the shares should be worth on a whole basis versus a partial interest basis. And these studies that are done and publicized that you can purchase by subscription give you an example of what the discount for lack of control would be by simply purchasing a minority interest in an entity like that. Then down here at the bottom of this scale, you have a non-marketable minority interest value. Non-marketable doesn't mean you can't sell it at all and it's worth nothing. It just means that it doesn't, it's not freely traded. It's not something that you see traded on a normal basis. So like me trying to sell 10% of my company just because I need to raise some money is what I would call a non-marketable interest. I might find a buyer, but I'm going to have to discount it and discount it for less than what that 10% share would be worth. For that, what do we look through for data? They actually have restricted stock studies that have been done over the years, and these studies continue to go on and on over the years, and they're published, and basically they show what shares and companies sell for, and then they share what restricted shares sell for, and those are the ones that can't be sold except to other partners or to family members of partners. This happens a lot, so, you know, I read a lot of partnership agreements where, you know, you've got the general partner and you've got limited partners, and the limited partnership is set up so that those partners can only, they can only sell to the other partners or to their family members or their family members. And that type of thing happens a lot. So there are other examples of how stock can be restricted, but those restricted stock studies will show the discounts for lack of marketability. And that is one of the ways that we come up with a discount for lack of marketability. So DLOM is discount for lack of marketability, whereas DLOC is discount for lack of control. So here's another sort of way to look at levels of value. So you have a minority interest down here. Pure minority interest, no control features. You have minority interest with cumulative voting rights. Minority with swing vote attributes. That would be in a situation where you have a whole bunch of clusters around that 50% mark, perhaps, or anywhere in the scale, and you have the ability to swing the vote because you have enough shares that could potentially, if there are five partners and you're one of them, then you know you could potentially swing the vote. That's what that is. Minority with the largest block of equity interest, obviously worth more. Two equity holders, each with 50% interest, 51%. So these are the kind of levels that we look at when we talk about our control discounts and marketability discounts and how we rate these, you know, and this is very subjective. One of the reasons why accountants don't always do well at valuation is because accountants don't like subjectivity. They like to be able to basically do a calculation and say this is the answer. Well, valuation is an art, not a science, and so oftentimes we have to actually apply subjectivity. So if our restricted stock studies and our, you know, say, you know, an average discount for marketability is 35%, and then the average discount for control is 30%, then we look at, we just kind of do some plus or minuses, and we have to consider where we fit on these scales and come up with something that makes sense. And there isn't a right or wrong answer. But if you have to go to court over it, you need to be able to defend how you came up with that number, because they're going to ask. So you have these kind of things in your file, and you say, this is what I used. I started from here, and these are the scale. This is the scale that I worked through to come up with where I think it should fit.
I have a question.
Yes?
In court, can they challenge, even though you have a basis for evaluation or for an aspect of evaluation,
mm-hmm.
can they challenge that basis and say, well, why didn't you use SOAR? They usually aren't that specific.
Yeah. Happens all the time. You know, oftentimes, you know, if you're in a litigation scenario, both sides will have their own expert, and one's going to challenge the other's methodology, or they're gonna challenge the inputs. And then, in these real big cases that happen in Delaware, for example, they have the chancery courts, and the chancery court judges actually have evaluation backgrounds, and the judges oftentimes will go back and they'll do their own evaluation and say, we don't disagree with either one of you two. And we're going to do it differently. There were two cases recently on that had to do with shareholder dissents, and one had to do with a shareholder dissent was the Dell case, and there was one that came after that, I can't think of the name of it, where the judge did his own evaluation. Both of the two experts had done a discounted cash flow evaluation, and the judge came back and he actually ended up using the stock's trading price as the value, which was higher. So these are the different methods of a business valuation that we use. These are the primary methods. And it doesn't matter whether if you're doing real estate, you have some of these things, the same things. You have the asset approach, which is also called the cost approach. You have the market approach, and you have the income approach. And we have different methods that fall underneath those three major categories. Oops. Just went way backwards. So under the asset approach method, we have what's called the adjusted net assets method. And this is the one that I was mentioning earlier that's typically used when you're valuing a company on the liquidation basis. However, you kind of have to do this approach anyway, because this is how you determine whether or not the company is a going concern. So even if you come up with a value, you do this valuation, you come up with, you know, 50% of what the value by the income approach comes up with, and you know you have a going concern, and you can throw this out. But it has to be, you have to start with this, because this is how you get a baseline or a floor value, the value of the assets. It's basically the fair market value of all the assets less the fair market value of total liabilities gives you the adjusted net assets value. It usually does not capture goodwill. And it's usually used, only relied upon when a business needs to be liquidated.
Jim?
Yes?
Quick one. What do you mean by pre-market value bound liabilities?
Believe it or not, liabilities can actually have value. People purchase debt. And let's say, for example, someone owner finances something with a 0% interest rate, and someone else buys that debt, they can pay a different price for it than what's actually on the books for. Depends on methods of accounting, but basically you want to make sure that your liabilities and your assets are at market value.
I was thinking about bonds.
True. True, very true. Financial instruments, good example. So in the market approach basically looks at sales of businesses, and there are two types that you can look at. You can look at the guideline public companies method, and I don't use this in Cayman because I don't think it has a lot of applicability here, but it's used fairly widely in the States. If you have a company that even though it might be a privately held company, it does something similar to what public companies do, just on a much smaller scale. So in the guideline public companies method, it compares price to earnings ratios of publicly traded companies in the same industry, and then you make adjustments for things like the size, because the size of the company will actually reduce that multiple, the smaller you go. So that's one way of looking at it. It's something that I would say is one of the least popular methods used for valuing privately held enterprises is this, because when you look at multiples for large companies, publicly traded companies that are on major stock exchanges are massive and compared to most of the valuations that we do. So they're a completely different scale. Then you have the guideline transaction method, which basically looks at the prices on a multiple basis paid for private companies. In the US, there are different databases that you can subscribe to, and so you look up by the NAICS code, you know, for plumbing companies, whatever it is, and it'll give you anywhere from zero up to hundreds of sales that have occurred in the last